الله أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين أما بعد Dear brothers and sisters in Iman, today we are moving ahead with a different discussion in the area of Islamic etiquettes and Islamic adab. There is a very important discussion. I believe this discussion exists in every faith, in every religion, in every culture. But in Islam, it is, I believe, little bit more emphasized compared to other religions or other cultures. And that is the respect and respect of parents and being kind and nice and more dutiful toward your parents. Although, as I said, in every religion, and in every culture, there is some emphasis and some recommendation that how one should engage and how one should deal with his or her parents. In Islam, we see that the highest authority is, of course, our Lord, our God, our Creator, our Rabb, our Khalik, our Malik is Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. He is authority of all other authorities. He is the supreme being and the supreme authority. And after Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, then if we see in the hierarchy comes the Anbiya, messengers, and of course our A'imma, Ahlul Bayt, alayhimu salatu wassalam. So they are the second most important authority which we have to be mindful, which we have to obey, which we have to please, which we have to look up to for directions and directives in our life. So after Allah, it is the messenger of Allah and other messengers and Anbiya and A'imma alayhimu salatu wassalam. Then after these two divine authorities, the most important authority and the most senior authority in our human circle, in our life, is the authority of parents. Father and mother, these are most important authority in our life. They are not only someone that who have authority upon us, actually they are the one that who have been most kind and beneficent and helping and caring and supporting us from the beginning of our life up till the point wherever we are. They are the one that who brought us in this world. They are our biological parents, and then they are the one that who took care of us in each and every need, whatever we had when we were very young, when we were growing, even when we become adults, we behave that we are adult and now we don't need any help, we don't need any support, or we don't need anyone to take care of us. But parents always feel responsibility. They always worry about their children or about their sons and daughters, even if they are grown, and they always pray for them. They always do whatever they can do to help them. So it shouldn't be only the matter of authority, but it is also that how much they are really concerned about us and how much they love us and how much they are kind with us. Now in Islam, one has to bear in mind that in Quran, at many times Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He spoke about Himself, then He mentions parents right after Himself. So He places parents right after Him as an authority or as a very important entity. So it is God, Lord, Allah, and then after Him He puts parents as another important authority. The authority of Anbiya and A'imma is part of the authority of God also. So when God is there mentioned as authority, many times it is already applied, alaykum salam, it is already applied and it is understood that if you take God as authority, you have to take His messengers and His representatives also as authority. So in those places it is applied or it is understood. Sometime very explicitly when He outlines, then He mentions about Anbiya and Ulul Amr also. But parents are very important for us as Muslims, and we Muslims were a nation or a community that who always understood it very well. Now in this modern day and age, modern time, under the influence of certain other civilizations, we see a little bit change in the new generation, that the new generation is also getting the color and the effect and the symptoms of the other communities and other nations. And sometime abandoning parents, sometime forgetting parents, sometime disobeying them or not being that kind and that nice and that obedient as they are supposed to be. But those are the effects of other cultures and other faiths and other communities on our new generation. We must make sure within our community that we always respect our parents, we respect the people who are in the age of our parents. They might not be our parents, but they are in the same age of our parents. So we should look at them as our uncles, as our aunts, if they are in the same age group. Matter of fact, in Islam, it is highly recommended to be respectful to your those that who are older than you, and be very kind and very nice towards those who are younger than you. So be kind with those who are younger than you and be respectful to those who are older than you. I am mentioning here some of the adab which are given to us in ahadith. And these are somewhat the rights of our parents, or these are the adab in the area of the parents. First of all, it is mandatory on children, and when we say children, it doesn't mean that they have to be minors, even if they are grown ones. They themselves have now their own children. They are still children of their parents. So people may think that now I am not child anymore, I am 20 years, I'm old, I'm 30 years old, I'm 40 years old, I'm 50 years old. But no matter how old you are, but you are still a child to your father or to your mother. You are children of your parents. So we will use this terminology so the grown one shouldn't feel excluded from that one. It is mandatory on children to maintain very kind relations with their parents, and they maintain very polite and pleasant relations with their parents, and they listen to them with respect, and they honor their requests, or they should honor their recommendations. When they recommend something, then children should listen to it and they should put it into the practice. Disobeying one's parents is one of the major sins. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. When one disobeys his or her parents, one commits a major sin. It deprives you from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This disobedience and disrespect to parents becomes a barrier between you and between the acceptance of your dua from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometime we get some other sufferings, some other problems, just because we have been unkind and not very respectful to our parents. So respect of parents is very important in Islam, and we must, alaykum salam wa rahmatullah, and we must maintain that. I know sometimes people have this question. They say, yes, Allah wants us to be respectful to our parents, and I also would like to be respectful to my parents, but the problem is my parents don't deserve that respect. They are not good. They are not that kind. My father is like this, or my mother is like this, and people will kind of now finding faults with their parents. God didn't say that you be kind with your parents if they are good. You be kind with them if they are kind with you. You do good with them if they are good with you. If that is the case, then what is the difference between parents and anybody else? Because you have to be good with anybody who is good with you. You have to be kind with anybody who is kind with you. So then what's the big deal? So the issue is that you have to be kind and respectful and nice with your parents no matter what. That's the issue. So even God forbid, if they are not that good as you would like to see them good, or as they were supposed to be good, they are held responsible to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will judge them and Allah will take care of them at His own. But your job as their children is to still be nice and still be kind with them and respectful to them. So that is number one. Number two, it is an adab, and I'm sure that alhamdulillah it is being practiced in our community and we don't have any problem in this area. But there were some cultures or some areas where people were not educated, and sometimes they would start calling their father or their mother by name. In Islam, it is strictly forbidden to call your father or call your mother by name. So they are supposed to call them dad, or they are supposed to call them mom, or whatever the name what you use. In every culture, in every language, there are different ways. Ammi, Abba, or mom, or dad, or whatever meaning, but it never ever one should call their father or their mother when you call upon them by name. Number three, it is disrespect to your parents that if you walk in front of them. Now, walking in front of your parents is forgiven for the children at very young age, when they are babies, so babies and very young children, so they are forgiven because they cannot maintain that. And it's safer that if they are walking in front of their parents, so parents can really keep eye on them and make sure that they are safe and there is nothing problem with them. So it's fine as long as when they are young. But when you grow, and now you are grown up and you are an adult, then walking of a son or daughter in front of parents is considered kind of something which is against the adab. Unless if it is need, if you are walking in front of them holding their hand, for example, it is rain, it is alaikum salam, it is snow, it is you are helping them holding their hand, or it is a requirement, need, and it is serving some purpose, and it is something that the father also is in agreement. And in culture or in that society, when people look at you, it is not considered as a disrespect to your father or mother, then that's fine. There are certain scenarios where you will be walking in front of them, but it is agreed upon, it is something that your father also doesn't mind. People, when they will look at you, it's also something which is understood, it is something that people will understand, so that's fine. But other than that, it is a respect that father should be asked to walk in front, and the son or the daughter should be walking behind or on side of the father, side by side, and little behind than walking in front, because that is the adab which Islam teaches us. And same is the girls and their mother and their mom. So the mother should be offered to walk in front, and the girl should be walking behind or right or left on the side of their mother. Unless, again, if it is needed, if walking in front is required and it is serving some purpose, then that's fine. But normally, never ever a son or daughter should walk in front where the father or the mother is walking behind, when it is considered a kind of disrespect. Similarly, the next other way is that when you are, for example, your father comes in your room, or you go together in a restaurant, or you go to an office, or you go somewhere, and you are entering together as a group. So it is disrespect and it is discouraged that the son or daughter should go and get seated before the father or mother is seated. So first, it's adab, it's a courtesy, it's a protocol that you should offer your father or mother to sit down, and when they are seated, then you go and be seated. But father is standing and mother is standing, and they don't know where to sit or how to sit, or they are still taking care of some other things, and sons and daughters, they go and sit on the seats, and so this is a disrespect. Again, those who are forgiven, those are very young children. Very young children, they don't have, meaning, those kind of things, so parents also don't mind them going and sitting and on the seats. So when they are very young, they are babies, then it's fine. But when you are grown up and when you are adult, or in the age when you are not adult but you are kind of in an age where you know what is good and what is bad, then it is the time that you should first see that your father or mother should sit down, then you go and you sit. Number 5, one shouldn't do anything that people blame and curse your father or your mother for it. Sometimes people, they will go and bother other people, disrespect other people, or do some ugly things and shameful things. So when people look at you doing those ugly things or shameful things, they will not only pick on you, or they will not only yell and scream on you, but they will also say bad things about your father and your mother, that who raised you. They will kind of disrespect your family and your father and mother because of your wrongdoing, because of your this bad behavior. Because you are not behaving properly, you are doing the wrong things, so people are not only going to pick on you, but they are going to pick on your father. They are going to pick on your mother. They are going to curse them, or they are going to disrespect them. And particularly if your father or mother is a known person, enjoys some special title in the community, some special respect, those children have to be even more careful, because you are now a kind of liability of your or the source of honor or dignity for your parents. Your father is somebody that people look to him with respect. Your father or your mother is a leader or a teacher or somebody that people have some special respect for him. So when you will do some ugly thing or some wrong thing or some thing which is not good, so people will look at you and they will laugh at your father or your mother, that this is the training what he or she is providing to his own son or his own daughter at home. So your responsibility becomes higher and bigger, and that is why we all talk about the great attributes of Hazrat Fatima Zahra Salamullah Alayha, because she was a daughter that who made her father proud of her. The father never got any complaint or any time ashamed because of his daughter. Actually, her daughter's conduct was a kind of conduct that which made Prophet always proud. Similarly, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain and other children. So it's important to respect the parents directly, but at the same time one has to live a kind of life that because of you, people increase in their respect for your parents instead of losing the respect of your parents when they look at you, or even curse your parents because of your wrongdoings. So that is also very important. Number six, which is not very relevant in our times, but it was used to be at one time, because there was a time when there were slaves and the slavery was still around. So the issue is that if your father or your mother is slave or slave girl, somebody owns them, and you are grown up and you have resources and you have money and you can go and free them, then it is your responsibility to go and pay the money and get your father or your mother freedom and free them. But thank God that now we are in an age and time where we don't have this curse of slavery. Everybody is free and everybody is enjoying the freedom, and freedom itself is one of the big bounties and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Recite a salawat. It is also an adab and a right of parents upon their children that if your father or your mother have debts and you are grown up and you have financial resources available at your disposal, then you should pay the debts of your parents and free them off from those debts, which are of course always a source of kind of inconvenience and a kind of burden. So when they are alive, you are alive, so whenever you have money and you see they are under debts, and this debt is something that which is causing some inconvenience for them or some problem for them, so you should go ahead and pay off their debts and give the relief to your parents. Sometime it happens that it is after their death that God forbid your father or your mother died, and you discover and you know that they had debts. It's good to keep the record, first of all, for parents. I'm speaking here now. First I was speaking to the kids, now I'm speaking with the parents. It's good for parents to keep the record that these are the things which I have borrowed from others, and I owe this much to, for example, this person. I owe this much to this person. I owe this much to this person, or whatever your lane deans are, whatever your transactions are, whatever money you have borrowed, whatever you have taken from others. So everything should be documented, it should be written down in a very clear manner, and your children or your wife or your spouse must know that this is all what your transactions or your hisab kitab or your lane deen are. So it should be very clear, and it should be documented, and it should be written down. And similarly, if other people owe you, you have lent money or other things to other people, it is also your responsibility to keep it documented and let your wife and your children know, either on the time or it should be in writing. So later on they open the envelope and they see that you had lent your money or your things to others, and so they can claim later on, or they can receive it. Recite a salawat. So in Islamic business or in Islamic lifestyle, it is highly recommended that all the transactions and all these muamalat and all these lending things and borrowing things, and that should be documented and it should be written down. Even back home it was a culture. Here people many times, I don't think they practice that, but back home people were used to put their valuable things as amanat, as trust with some people in the family or in the community. It is being practiced back home even now to some extent. In Iran, I remember that there were people that who would bring these very valuable things sometime and put under the custody or in the amanat of some maraje taqlid or some senior clergy, senior ulama in the neighborhood, the imam of their masjid, for example. It was because being the imam in masjid in Iran is also a very important position. In Iran, they don't hire just any average alim as resident alim or as imam of the masjid. So normally these people are highly learned scholars, very pious people, and very senior people. So the people in those locations, whenever they had those valuable things, sometime this is jewelry, sometime this is money, cash, sometime these are the important documents, like what is this, deeds, for example, deeds of your properties, sometime these are some other things which are very important to people, and they don't want to see anybody else. Because they still didn't have this custom of putting these things in safe deposits or in banks or in those kind of places, they would look around somebody with the credibility and they would go and put this amanat. So these maraje taqleed, I remember Ayatollah Makarim and his office, this was a custom that he had a particular register or an office and a person in charge who would register right away. For some time, when we were buying home, one of our option was that, because in Iran you cannot buy a property as a foreigner, so you have to keep it on the name of a local person. So students who were Indians or Pakistanis or Arabs, if they were in Iran and if they were buying these properties, so those of us who had our wives from Iran, so we had no problem, so we bought our properties in the names of our wives. But some of those that who didn't had this option, so then we would buy this property in the name of our teachers, or those maraje taqleed, or some of those ulama. So it's a millions of, meaning tuman's property, and you are buying in the name of somebody else. But then these people were so amin that they would write down in the documents and in the wasiyat for their family that if God forbid something happens to me, don't become waris of this particular property because this property is only in my name, but this doesn't belong to me. It is not my property. This property is, for example, Mr. So-and-so, and return to him when he comes or he claims. So they had to, everything has to be documented. So when we leave this world, and we don't have any guarantee that until which time we will live. Death can occur any time. Any time when it can happen. So all these lendings and all these transactions and all these things have to be documented at home. Spouse should know where you keep your records, or your children should know your records. So something that happens to you, so later on at least the family is not in mess and everybody knows that what is the issue. So the thing what we were discussing here is that it is a responsibility, and it is actually if it is in their reach, that the children should pay the debts of their parents. Again, if they can. But it is highly recommended for them. Number 8, it is one shouldn't speak with his or her father or mother in a rude way, or in a way that which is considered disrespect. They need to maintain respectful way of speaking with them. Quran says that don't even call uff to them. So sometime yelling and screaming and kind of making body language and nodding and shrugging shoulders and slamming doors and throwing dishes and all these kind of things are considered disrespect and they are sin. And a parent, and when you feel sometime kids feel disappointed in arguments with their children, and they would run and then they would throw things and they would slam doors and they would kind of shrug their shoulders. And if they are babies and very young children, so Allah is Kareem and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. And parents also don't take these things to their heart. They know they love their children. They know they are kids and they are minor. But God forbid if this behavior takes place from the grown ones and from the adults one, because adults are not supposed to disrespect their kids in any way possible, not only verbally but even by body language or by any way which is considered disrespect. Recite the salawat. If you are grown up and you have elderly parents, then it is your responsibility to maintain them, to provide them with their basic needs, whatever needs they have. So spending upon them, buying their libas, paying for their grocery, for making the home available to them, all whatever needs are. So these are the responsibilities of the children to look into and to nicely and gracefully and respectfully. They don't have to now give the impression that as they are spending charity on their old parents, and sometimes kids do that, or their spouses, while these were the parents, that it was the greatest pleasure for them to take care of their children. Their children were their first priority. They unfortunately had sometimes neglected their own parents because of these children. Many times they neglected their God and their prophet and their deen just because of these children. Sometime and many time in their life they neglected actually themselves and their own relief and their own desires and their own interests just because of these children. Now these children need to also remember that these are the parents who brought us in this dunya. They are our biological parents and we were their first priority. And now making your parents your last priority is not the fair deal. Your parents should also be your first priority, because they were the one who were very kind with you, they were noble with you. It was a greatest joy for a father to buy something good and nice for his son or daughter when going home and buying this toy for them, buying good food for them, buying good libas for them. So parents always go for the best of best when they are buying for their children. So the children also need to know this is time to give back. They need to also look into this, and they should feel thrilled and feel excited and feel honored when they are doing something for their parents, instead of feeling that, oh, old father, old mother, so I am just doing for him, and then it is just like a charity I am spending on my father or mother, and this is a blessing which I am giving to my father or my mother. No, that's not the case. Recite a salawat. So, taking care of them. Then, sometime it's not only the money, it's not only what you are buying for them like grocery or libas, it is your being around them, your time, your love, because you belong to them. Parents want to have their children around them, in front of them, or they want to see their children visiting them often and very frequently. And they want to, meaning you think you are grown up and you know what you are doing and everything is in control. But as an old father or old mother, they are always worried. They have worries. They want to know that you are fine and you are doing okay and everything is good for you. So it's remaining in touch with them. Keep them filling with information, sending them always message, calling them, writing to them, and remaining in touch with them, letting them know that you are fine and everything is fine and what you are doing. So, or visiting them, going and spending time with them. A time comes when we don't enjoy anymore spending our time with our parents. We enjoy our time only with our peers, with our own friends, with our own people of our own age. And we like to get into, for example, into the hobbies and games and all that. That company is more lively and more enjoyable, which is understandable, but not at the cost of cutting time from the company of the parents. Parents are also very important factor in our life and in our family. So I cannot say my time is all for my peers and my friends and for my games and for my colleagues and for those people, and I am not going to, only for the poor mother or father at the end of day before going to sleep, I will go in her room and I say, Salam Mama or Salam Ma, I am here and now I am going to bed and you go also and sleep in your bed. So that shouldn't be the only higher by just 1 minute time for the father or 1 minute time for the mother in the early in the morning or late in the evening. So find some time and go and sit with them and talk to them and ask about your stories of your childhood and ask about the stories when you were growing up, how you were growing up, how was the family doing, what were the family habits, family culture, family stories, family history. So our mothers are our encyclopedias. Our fathers are our encyclopedias. Much more information if you want to know about your father, your mother, yourself, your family. Everything is all the information, but you need to sit with them. You need to go and enjoy their company. Make them talk. It will take some time, but make them talk to you. Make them to speak with you and enjoy. They enjoy your company and you enjoy their company. So that is something which is important. It is not only the money order, that every month I send that much money to my father or money to my father or my mother, or just buying a mug for them or buying a shirt for them or something like that, Father Day and Mother Day. That is a very superficial one. So it should be much more and much more meaningful. And that is particularly the Islamic way and the Muslim way and the way of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad alayhi wasallatu wasallam. Last two things and I will finish. We don't have much time now left. One thing is that it is act of ibadat to look at the face of your father or mother. And if you look just at your father and mother, that they are the that authority which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has appointed upon you, and they are your biological fathers and mothers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and your prophet and your imams want to be around them and help them and take care of them, and they are source of blessing. Just looking at the face of your father or mother is a sawab, and you get the ibadat, and you know there are very few things that just looking at them is sawab. It is the house of Allah, Kaaba. It is the Quran, the text, the Mushaf. If you look at it, you get sawab. It was the face of Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, an-nazru ila wajhi Ali ibn Abi Talib ibadah. And then we have the hadith that after the Kaaba, after the face of Imam Ali, after the Quran, it is the face of your own father and face of your own mother. Just looking at that is sawab. And the last thing is that don't forget them when they leave this world. Remember them always, pray for them, make dua for them, and keep doing the acts of charity and acts of kindness in their name to keep sending them sawab. You remember them here, they will remember you inshallah there. And this touch should always remain. Thank you very much, and may Allah bless you.